Yeah, good morning, everybody. I am Dr. Selvi Subramanian. This is one of my research area, which is pearescence. This is a insect toxin. We are analyzing this toxin for various functional aspects. It is obtained from white cabbage butterfly. Not only this toxin, there are other insect toxins also available. There is a window in the side. Can I remove that? It is hiding my screen. Okay. Yeah. So not only pearescence, there are other toxins which are also obtained from insects, which are like insects and other organisms, lysosome, melittin, cercopin, defensin. These are some of the toxins obtained from other organisms. These toxins have much value. For example, lysozyme, it can be used for degrading bacterial cell wall, and melittin is obtained from bee venoms, and then cercopin for some bacterial purpose, and defensin. These have some function in their insects, as well as we also exploit for some other purpose. Similarly, the pearescence, which is obtained from Pieris genus, and it has several species in it, Nappi, Rape, Brassicae, Canadia, and so on. So there are already 6 pearescence genes, pearescent toxins, as well as genes characterized to date. And we have been doing experiment on pearescent 4, 5, and 6. We will see what are their function. And before that, we will see something about what is their function in the insects. In insects, they are expressed more in the stages of larva, and in some species, it is expressed more in pupae. That itself tells it is a defense compound for that in insects also. Say, because they are sedentary in lifestyle when it is at a pupal stage. So this toxin helps to defend the invading pathogen or pest so that it can kill them. So this can survive very well. So these toxins, people were working on these toxins, and then they found out they have a lot of anti-cancerous activity. So you can see the inhibitory levels of this toxin present in larva, pupa, and adult. You can see that the amount of toxin is produced more in the larval and pupal stages compared to the adult stage. And IC50 values are also higher in the case of larva and pupae. In adult, it is not, because as we all know, adults can fly from one place to another, but larva will be attached to one leaf or in one plant, and then pupa will be hanging from one point. So it has to defend itself. But this toxins are very, very poisonous. So people attempted it by producing it in a E. coli cell, but they couldn't do it. So what they did is they always isolate this toxin either from the larva in mass cultured larval stages, or they will do it by recombinantly expressing it in E. coli. But they found out all the cells which they tried to express this protein killed the cell. So they need to do a cell-free system for expression of this pearescent. And this pearescent is found to induce apoptosis. Apoptosis is a controlled cell death. So this is also because of this property, it can also be used for some exploited as anti-cancerous property. This TMK cell line, they are nothing but gastric cancer cell lines, gastric carcinoma cell lines. And in that, this toxin was found to be having much effect. Not only that, in HeLa cell, there are so many other cell lines, they have found out it has activity. You can see here in this picture. So this is A, This is a normal cell line control, no treatment. After 6 hours of treatment, you can see the cells, 9 hours of treatment and 12 hours of treatment. So this is a phase contrast microscope. In later, you will see a color micrograph in which you will see condensation of the nuclei clearly and then formation of the micronuclei. All those things can be seen clearly in the coming slides. So not, and the mechanism apoptosis is found to be mitochondrial pathway, and also they have found out this protein has a ADP ribosylating activity. We will see that later, that ribosylation activity, this toxin binds to the DNA and form an adduct, and then it starts cleaving the DNA. So that is like how it defends the insect. So it binds to the DNA and then cleaves. You can see that incubation of the DNA at several hours of incubation, 0 hour, 6 hour, 9 hour and 12 hour incubation, you can see here. In the 9th hour, you can start seeing some smear at the bottom. So this is intact DNA. After incubation with its toxin, you can see it is degrading a little bit. After 12 hours, you can see completely the intact DNA itself is disappearing. So that is how it defends that. So the foreign DNA which enters the cell will be cleaved off. So that is one mechanism of defense. So I already mentioned there are 6 piericins identified so far, 7 actually. Piericin 1 and 1B are obtained from Pieris rapé, but 1 is from Japanese origin and 1B is from UK, and these people have also developed a methodology to mass produce this, but it is patented, so it is not available. But we worked with Pieris 5 and 6, so Pieris Canada and Pieris Nappi. For our butterfly also we obtained from northeastern region because it is a collaborative project with Mizoram University. So butterflies obtained from northeastern region were used for isolating the Pieris 5 and 6. We will see one by one what is the nature of each and every piericin. Piericin 1 is an 850 amino acid cytotoxic protein found in the pupae of cabbage butterfly, Pieris rapé. And that this is a protein toxin because you can see it is 850 amino acid protein, but it is a toxin. So it has a N-terminal region, which function is ADP ribosyl transferase domain. C-terminal region is bound to receptor binding domain. So we said it has anti-cancer property. So it can bind to the receptors of the human cell and then it can enter inside and then do the ribosyl transferase activity. In vitro expressed polypeptide containing this, if you do it individually, N-terminal and C-terminal domain separately, sometimes the activity is not found fully. So here, this is a color photograph, fluorescence microscopy image of Pieris 1 treated with HeLa and MeB4 cells. HeLa is the human carcinoma cell, whereas the MeB4 is like a control. It doesn't have any antigen expressing any melanoma antigen. So it is like observed as a control. So with the higher amount of the temperature, varying temperature, 37 degrees centigrade, all these, you can see the effect of the Pieris 1, whereas MeB4 cells are resistant to the effect of Pieris 1. So the fluorescence or emission will tell the nucleic acid is dispersed or it is cleaved, or sometimes we can, in this type of images, you can see the full cell occupied with nucleic, only that is stained. So you can, whenever you see the full of DNA, so it is fragmented. So introduction of N-terminal polypeptide alone by electroporation also induced cell death in HeLa cell. So N-terminal polypeptide is, we said it is for ADP ribosyl transferase. That is the activity. So C-terminus is for binding to the receptor and getting into the cell. So that also has this activity in the mammalian cell. Pyrosine 1, we said it is a DNA ADP ribosylating activity. ADP, everybody is know, ATP is the adenosine triphosphate, ADP is the diphosphate, and this is ribosylating the N2 position of the guanine base of the DNA. Like this, it attaches to the DNA, so it transfers the ADP to the guanine base in this particular position. So this is, you can see, deoxycytosine, deoxyguanosine, deoxyadenosine, and deoxyguanine. In this only you can attach the ADP, so it, you have a, another peak. So it is labeled and then found out where it gets attached to it. So there are also some proteins which are ADP ribosylating the protein. This is ADP ribosylation function is for DNA. So it is cleaving the DNA. So these protein ADP ribosylation also involved in anti-cancerous activity. So unlike other ADP ribosylating toxin, the acceptor site for ADP ribosylation by pyrosine 1 is in the N2 position of the guanine base in the DNA. So the details, what is the mechanism of the toxicity? So when we study how it kills the invading pathogen in the insect. So after, when you know the mechanism properly, then we can exploit it for some other purpose of our use, for human use. Like that only they have understood the function of the. The C-terminal region has sequence similarity with botulinum toxin and contains lectin domain of the ricin superfamily. So this is only we are investigating now. So N-terminal is ADP ribosylating activity that will attach to the DNA. The C-terminal region also has similarity. The botulinum toxin is some bacterial toxin which is involved in pertussis and some cholera toxin also. Diphtheria for these and all mosquito toxin. These similarity triggers us what could be the special function of the pyrosine. So we were investigating all these property in the pyrosine 5 and 6, because when we started this work up to 4, the pyrosine family were identified, characterized, and some of the functions were identified. Now you can see the amount of pyrosine 1 which is produced. This is the first pyrosine 1, the paper which is published earlier than us, 2004 itself. We have published in 1918 like that. So in the 2004, they have measured the quantity of the protein which are the toxin expressed at various larval stages. You can see here. 1, 2, 3, 4, all these lanes correspond to the first instar larvae, second instar larvae, third instar, fourth instar. You can see it increases, and after that an adult it starts decreasing. That is another way they have correlated with the defense compound of this defensive nature of this protein. Pyrosine 1B, so there is two groups simultaneously working on pyrosine 1 from the same species, but because of their geographical difference, there are some differences in the protein sequence. So, and also they found out separately that they have anti-cancerous property as well as ADP ribose. So these way two people worked simultaneously. One is a UK group, another is a Japanese group. The pyrosine 2, it is obtained from Pyrus brassicae. It also contains an apoptosis-inducing protein. And the cDNA of pyrosine 2, this, all of them are approximately 850, 880, like that amino acid. And all of them have cytotoxicity effect. And then pyrosine 2 and 1 share 91% similarity at the cDNA level. Pyrosine 2 shows regional sequence similarity with certain ADP ribosylating toxin. Earlier we said pertussis, cholera toxin, and diphtheria toxin, all those are connected with pyrosine 1. Pyrosine 2 is 91% similarity to the pyrosine 1. So this is another image which shows the function of the pyrosine 2. Earlier images showed the function of pyrosine 1 and 1B. So most probably all the pyrosines have been established to have anti-cancer property. This is against TMK, HeLa. All these are human cell lines which are specific for some cancerous. And then after, you can see this control, you can see the cell structure. But after treating with this PRSN2, you can see dark, clear dots. That tells that condensation of the chromatin happens. And sometimes you can also see small, small dots that corresponds to micro nuclei formation, or you can see here nuclear fragmentation also happens because of the incubation of this toxin. But we have found out that the expression of this toxin in a cell-free system only can make more amount of this. So we had tough time isolating this toxin from the native larval species. And because it cannot be produced in more quantities, we have to mass culture the insect. So we went on to characterize the gene and then clone the gene into a insect cell system. Because it is an insect toxin, we assumed that insect cell can be alive, because this toxin can be withstood by the insect cell, because it is originated from the insect cell. Similarly, PRSN 3 and 4 are from some other species, malate and some more thing. Okay. So the partial peptide sequence of 3 and 4 purified from pupae were identical to the deduced amino acid sequence or ORF. So here, between the 3 and 1 and 2 is extensively researched, and 3 and 4 to a certain extent. And there also you can see the clear condensation of the normal cell line, and then after each and every, this is fluorescently labeled with Cy3, Cy green and blue label. And now we will move on to whichever PRSN which we are working with, PRSN 5. Then this is from PRS Canidia. Also, I mentioned from Northeastern, because between different geographical regions, this PRSN will be having some mutation in the protein. That mutation sometimes enhances the toxic level or sometimes decreases. So that is also found in several PRSN. You can see that PRSN 1 and 1B from two different geographical regions, they have showed some 91% similarity only. So also between 3 and 4, they expressed more in the pupal stage, and some more in the last 5 instar. For our this PRSN 5, 5th instar larvae found to exhibit cytotoxicity. So we have collected PRSN, crude PRSN isolated from the cultured larval tissue. And then later on, we moved on to all this establishing the. So this is a picture I was mentioning. So cytotoxicity and morphologic assessment of apoptosis induced by PRSN 5. So this A and D, this is control. A and D untreated. This is the normal cell, how it looks like. Pointer. Okay. So this is normal cell. And then B, it is about 24 hours treatment, and E is also 24 hours treatment. C and F, they correspond to 48 hours. So the normal cell is green in color. As it moves to DNA fragmentation or chromosome condensation, you will distribution of nuclei, yellowish green color. You can see here within that yellowish green color. So nuclei is fragmented and it is all over the cell. It is a eukaryotic cell, so it should be in only one place. But because of this activity or the toxicity of this protein, it is fragmented, and so it is distributed all over. So that is how the cell is cytotoxic effect of the cell is exhibited. So recombinant PRSN 5, I mentioned when it is very difficult to isolate PRSN 5 from the cells as such, because mass culturing of larva is needed in order to do all these experiments. So initially we did all this screening with the different cancer cell line with the crude isolates from the larva, and later we plan to clone it into insect cell line, and then recombinant PRSN5 also established with this apoptotic cell death. So we isolated from insect cell line, that is Spodoptera littera, SF9 and SF21 cells were used for expressing this piericin 5 toxin. And then in addition, we also did some in silico. All this process for identifying what is the function, just before doing that, we also completed the in silico study, how it forms adduct. You can see here, it forms adduct with the DNA. You can see the DNA. And then this is the N-terminal and C-terminal region of the protein. And this is the DNA, how it attaches to the DNA. And then there are some residues, some residues in the amino acid, which will allow the cleavage of the DNA. So that is how the apoptotic activity or anti-cancer cytotoxic activity are happening in the piericin 5. Piericin 6 is also obtained from NAPI. So simultaneously we worked with two, because two species we could get it from northeastern region, and that also is approximately 850 amino acid. That also exhibited the cytotoxic activity against the HeLa cell. All these are cancerous cell lines. They are more sensitive, means they died because of the incubation of this toxin. So both the naturally obtained crude toxin as well less recombinantly expressed toxin, both showed cytotoxic and apoptotic activity. Piericin 5 and 6 have similarity of 94.3%. You can see that all the piericins are compared in the in silico analysis. You can see one is obtained from RAPE and 1B is also RAPE, but two different geographical region, two from Brassicae, and then three from Malate and Karatagi and Canidia, and this is NAPI. The last one is from NAPI. So you can see here NAPI. So it is a similarity matrix. You can see the amino acid, 850 amino acid, 49, one is 850, 858, one. So approximately that range only. So the sequence similarity is given, and some of them are you can see piericin 5 and 6 is 95.3% similarity, whereas 4 and 5 is only 72%. And the piericin 3 and 4, it's together, and then some earlier it was not completely sequenced but not characterized as that of 1 and B. So you can see the amino acid and nucleotide similarity here, and this amino acid sequence. So this is that blue box is nucleotide similarity, and this white box is amino acid sequence. You can see here, this is here also, here, and the four is completely divergent than the rest of the piericin. But now we have understood that it has anti-cancerous property. You can see this is for 6, I guess, piericin 6, which has, so all these are our research scholars publication. At the end, I have given all the references. 4 publications came out of this research. So this is also this is control. A and B will be control, and C and D will be incubation of the piericin 6 toxin. So now our undergraduate students, we have published all those things. Now we want to find out whether any other function is there for this piericin protein. Now we have established that piericin has anti-cancerous property, and because it cannot be produced in large quantities, we cloned them into insect cell line and then produced more quantity of that protein, and then established in the recombinantly expressed piericin also, it showed the cytotoxic and apoptotic activity and then fragmentation activity, all those things. Now we thought, we recently came across there are in the C-terminal, we saw there are some resin binding domains. These resin binding domains are present in piericin 6 and as well as 5, and we saw that they are also common in the toxins like botulinum toxin, cholera, pertussis toxin, all of them also have this resin binding domain. This resin binding domain recently reported to be, yeah, this was the motif which I said, QXW motif, that is one which interacts with the DNA and cleaves it. And then in the resin binding domain is artificially fused with some of the proteins, and they found out that in silico, they have found out they are binding to the SARS-CoV-2 key protein, this resin binding domain, in some other protein. So we examined the resin binding domain. There are a couple of, not only you can see all these green bars, they are some of the binding domains present in that, and whether they also have some antiviral activity. So we wanted to analyze that. So it is nothing but, because now everybody is doing online project, we thought maybe we will initiate some in silico analysis. So current work is to evaluate the antiviral activity of PRSN6 protein against SARS-CoV-2 key protein using in silico approach. The reason or the rationale behind is because it contains resin binding domain at the C-terminal domain. So this contains resin domains. You can see the amino acid coordinates. There are three domains present in it. And then this in silico approach to locate the resin already in SARS-CoV-2, some other paper, but it is an artificial protein which is embedded with the resin domain of some other like fusion protein, is found to show that it has inhibitory activity for the antiviral. So this also is used for all the proteins which are present in the SARS-CoV, that is spike protein. You can see COVID-2 spike protein. You can see the cyan color, and the green color is PRSN6, you can see. And then interface region is orange color, you can see. So similar, the same color coded for the other proteins which are present in the SARS-CoV-2 also. A docking study using a tool, HADOC, it is performed, you can see here. But out of this, only for the spike protein, we have got high value of interaction. This is a interface, this is for SARS-CoV-2, some other protein. This is... okay, different proteins. I have a list of here. Yeah, ACE2 spike protein, PRSN6 spike protein, and this spike protein and main protease which is present in the SARS-CoV, and then papain-like proteins which is present in the SARS-CoV-2, and RDRP, this is another protein. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 proteins are docked with the PRSN toxin, that is PRSN6 toxin. And we can see this value, -144 HADOC score. That is the one which shows the highest. Second one is spike. Both the spike proteins, they show higher minus values. That tells that it is a stable interaction. So, and all the other things are something to do with the docking program. So based on this energy, minimum free energy, we can say it is a stable interaction. So what next from this? So this interaction tells us the reason for resin binding domain is resin binding domain, which is made in a synthetic manner with a fusion protein. That is also an in silico paper. They have done this to show that resin domain has an inhibitory role in translation. So translation is stopped. So if this toxin or if this domain is present, toxin stops the translation. That means it will stop the protein synthesis. So if how the antiviral activity can come into existence, because if it stops the protein synthesis of the invading viral genome, then it is good. We can stop its multiplication. Only when it synthesizes the protein or it synthesizes the DNA or RNA. Also, it can form adduct with the DNA or the RNA, nucleic acid. So both way you can corner the virus. That is why we initiated this project. So this toxin, earlier we found it only in cell-free system you can do. And then during this our period, when we received the fund for expressing it in the insect cell, and then we mass produced it and then used it for all the other establishing the results, which is present in the 1, 2, and the same thing is hold good for 5 and 6. So artificially created PRSN and naturally obtained PRSN, all of them have cytotoxic effect, apoptotic effect. Mechanism is by mitochondrial pathway as well as by formation of ADP ribosylation. And now even now we 100 it matches only with the piracin, for the this domain matches with the other toxin. So if this toxin is useful, whether it can be used against host viral interaction. So in order to find that only, we did this exercise of online or in a online project with our undergraduate students. And then we are still working on it. We want to modify this motif, QXW motif. This is only present in this. And then if you remove this in silico mutation studies, if we perform, whether this activity or the interaction is lost, all those things, whether it has therapeutic activity against COVID-19, all that thing, some more in silico work we can do. But as such, we cannot experiment the virus in our labs with our biosafety facility. So once it is established with in silico experiments, and then it can be for... we can tie up with some other labs which are actually involved in experimenting with the virus. We can give our protein to them and then evaluate that for the antiviral property. So these are some of the references which came out of the Pearson 5. You can see the papers, all these from our study, recombinant Pearson 5, and then someone will be Pearson 6, and some for in silico paper, and some establishing the nature of the DNA, in vitro DNA binding activity and molecular docking, all these studies. Now we are moving slowly on to antiviral property. So this, in nutshell, I will summarize that Pearson proteins are having natural defense system for the insects. But after studying its mechanism, we can exploit it for anti-cancer activity. And now there are so many other agents for anti-cancer activity, but now our problem is this coronavirus. So we are moving ahead with whether there is antiviral activity present, because it is highly toxic. So we want to find out whether this some of the regions of this protein has antiviral activity. In silico, we have got some clues that the spike proteins, two of the spike proteins have some interaction to the pearson toxin. Whether it has any effect functionally, that has to be evaluated. Thank you.